with the ultimate goal of making more girls feel inspired and confident to lead healthy and active lifestyles, as well as exposing them to the many varied career opportunities that are vacant in the world of sports. So if I was to turn the clock back to when I was at school, I can remember my one and only meeting with a careers advisor. I was sat in front of a computer and I was asked to complete a survey, which I was told was the site of my chosen most ideal career. In anticipation of what I was going to be asked, I'd already given some thought to what I wanted to do when I grew up. I knew I liked sports, I liked helping young children at school, and I loved to be outdoors and to keep myself active. So I thought the obvious choice for me would be a PE teacher. So the end of the survey, the computer churned out the results, and there was my ideal job, a tree surgeon. Not only was I completely afraid of heights, I knew nothing at all about trees. I didn't get another chance to complete the survey, and more importantly, I didn't get the chance to talk to any of my teachers about working in the world of sports. No one really knew much about the sports industry, and when I made the decision to go to university to train as a teacher, it wasn't until I was there that I realised the wide and varied opportunities that were available to me within the industry. That was 16 years ago, and what I do know now is that there are many more amazing opportunities and jobs within the industry. But what I also know is that outside of my fields, we're not doing enough to support the next generation of girls. So why is it important that we offer girls the opportunity to meet women who work in the industry and to allow them the chance to find out why they do it? Well, we want to see more women working in the industry, and working in sport isn't an easy option. I think some people think that I've worked in the world of sport for a long time, and young people that I've worked with think that sport really is an easy option, but it's not. They say it's a pathway you choose if you're not particularly clever, or if you just want to play sport. It's a last resort. It's the one where you can really only be a coach, a physio, or if you maybe think you're good enough, you might make it in that league. What we don't tell the next generation is that it's an exciting and extremely fulfilling career to work in. And in fact, it is only an elite good sport to work in. Why not have ambition? If you're passionate about fashion, why not think about working for Nike? Why not think about working for Adidas? Or why not be like Lily Rice, who set up her own brand, Let's Sports, after she realised that there weren't enough clothing suited for women that would make them feel confident and comfortable to be active? Or if your passion lies within journalism, why not think about a career as a sports journalist? You may have seen the images that were flashing up at the beginning of the girls when they met an array of people over the last few months, such as the legendary Claire Boulding, Jane Duke from Sky Sports, both women who are very passionate about sport and broadcast and have managed to marry the two together and have had successful careers working in the industry. The problem, unfortunately, is particularly evident in the world of sport. Almost half of the national governing bodies, like the Football Association, and there are a few who look after rugby, are made up of less than a quarter of women on their boards. However, research carried out in 2007 showed that firms have the highest representation of women on their boards outperform those with the least. It simply doesn't make sense for sport to continue to ignore the role that women have to play at a high level. However, it's not just about learning about the wide varied opportunities in the industry. It's also about young girls understanding the relationship between playing sports and succeeding in their careers. There is a direct link between girls' participation in sport and greater achievements within higher education, and employment. In fact, a majority of leading female executives from around the world first found success through sport. And in a recent study by EY, 61% of those respondents said that being involved in sport had contributed to their career success, as well as nearly three quarters of them believing that a background in sport can help accelerate a woman's career. So have ambitions, girls. Aspire to be the best, and have the want to turn your passion for sport into a career. Mums and dads and teachers, remember that you play a huge role in shaping these girls' futures. Mums and dads, your role models, you may know it or not, and probably the number one fans of your daughters. And the role that you can play will impact on them not just now, but throughout their entire lives. We all have people who inspire us and help us make decisions. you make on our career pathway. And I'm fortunate enough to say that there are a number of people, both young, adults, in the room tonight that inspire me, and I know that will continue to inspire me throughout my career. So girls, you are so lucky. You have an amazing group of teachers here that have supported you, and you've been an absolute pleasure to work with on your journey. So embrace that, all of you, and aim for the stars. So thank you for your time, and it's now time to watch the film Bit of More Musical.
Hi, I'm Mimi Evans and we're from Highfield School in Derbyshire. So we're here at the UEL to interview some businesswomen who are interested in sports and to find out what inspired them to have a career in sport.
So when we first got here, Chris took us on a tour of the campus and it was amazing because we've never been to the university before. So it was amazing to see life at a university and inside the UEL. And we went through what we were going to try and get out of the interview. So we came up with ideas like whether they had to face any barriers and how they'd overcome them and how we can get a career in sport if we ever wanted to.
We're all really excited to interview the businesswomen and we're really excited to find out more about the industry.
Action.
I think it's really important for young girls to understand that there are so many different roles in the sports industry. It's not a sort of a cop-out or an easy job to go into sport. It's really difficult. You need a brain to work in sport, and the wider we can get that message, the better.
There's so many obstacles, I think, in any industry or any walk of life. Don't think there's not going to be obstacles, because actually the obstacles are really good. And my advice to overcome things like that is just always be true to yourself and always know who you are and be confident in yourself.
I think the importance to days like this, and I suppose exposing young girls to working in the sports industry, it just means that it opens doors for them and makes them understand that they can do it. If they enjoy sport, it is a legitimate profession to get into, and if talking to people like me helps them do that, then that's absolutely brilliant and all for it.
The world is your oyster, as they say, and you know, we've been making great strides and, you know, equality on the job front, and boys always think they're better at sports, but I mean, yeah, we just let them think that.
Speak to the people who are doing what you want to do and just take the benefit of their experience and their advice.
I think it's really important to sort of demystify sport as a career option. I think it's a bit blurred. I don't think people know what's out there, so if they can hear as many stories as possible, I think that'll inspire them into what they want to do.
I think the most important key message that's come out today is to take risks and just go for it, and not to go with what other people want you to do, to go with what you love to do. And there's loads of different routes that you can go off in sport. You don't have to tunnel yourself. You can do loads of different things. And it's been great to hear about all the different pathways that people have taken to get to where they are today.
Two questions to start with, Mr. Wills. What do you think the opportunities like this would provide the girls with? What's it do for the girls?
You know, I think watching that, that inspiration of working with those girls that we saw you working with, it's been amazing. I was looking at just how I felt meeting those people in the first instance. It must have taken you outside your comfort zone, and I hope it did. It's the challenge of doing that, and those participating in sport or working in sport, that's what sport does. Whether you're actually successful or not in the moment of a sporting event, actually what you learn from that is just massive. And that transfers it to my pleasure. So I hope you really did get that from it. I'll tell you something I hope you will bring back from it. I really hope you will bring what I think will be an inspirational opportunity. Something we can't do for all the white girls or all white youngsters. And I hope you'll bring that back into school and in some way find a way of using that to inspire others. I think that's an important part of this. It's all supports to do that. And I see that happening. What an opportunity. But again, yes, it's quite the tip of an iceberg. And it is here, the opportunity there to get right in the school.
As head teacher, would you like to see more opportunities that the girls have been exposed to over the last couple of months for more students, and how can we make that happen?
Yes, I would, of course. I'd really want to do that. That would be great. It's not going to happen. I suppose it goes back to the end of one of the same tools, it's that opportunity. How can we use that? We can show everyone that job. But how would we actually get them to try and engage in the way to engage you? That's perhaps the question behind it. So, yeah, it would be great for all of us to have that opportunity for something that comes from it. And almost, you know, you could talk about legacy in school and something sort of often living within the legacy of that. What's the legacy of this? You can actually see that. I think it would be life changing, but how do we actually get that picture? One of the things I see is that, and I'm sure these things are telling that the people are available to us in their 7 days, I feel, when they start looking towards leadership. And then people do need to talk to. And this is going to impact on that way. That would be a great way to talk to them. How is this going to impact on them?
Absolutely, and we'll come on to that in a moment when we get a chance to speak to the girls and the younger girls. And finally, how do you think that living an active lifestyle benefits young females in the long run and can it help in other areas of their lives, such as their schoolwork, the grades they may be working towards?
Well, I mean, with the ones that benefits an active lifestyle and healthy lifestyle, I think we're probably okay. I think the way to get it to benefit sort of beyond that model of long-term benefits that we know about. You spoke earlier, actually said something in what you were saying, which related to how sports people who are active, are actually successful in other parts of my life. I referred earlier to being a PE teacher, and I remember going to my head teacher and saying, we should be doing more PE, it will have an impact on other things, and it does, and I'm convinced about that. That brilliant feeling that it gives you when you participate, when you're active. I'm not talking about women, you know, that's great, but actually participating. And the goal that we get from that, what it does to you physically, and all the business we get, and all the technology, and that's a part of that. You know, we know all those things work. The challenges come out, the opportunities are for better, and come through that. And that, not to squash you, not to, to make people more successful, and more, the resilience it builds in people. And but again, it's a part of sport, but it's a part of one. So I think that's what I would agree with.
Thank you, Mr. Wills. That's fantastic. Rada.
Hello.
Rada from Women in Sport, one of my colleagues. What do you think that Women in Sport do to inspire more young girls and women to think about careers in sport and active lifestyles?
So we do lots of different things. I'll break it down into little bits to give you some examples. So, kind of like the stuff that we've done with you guys, actually talking about what work means for me, what that industry is, that it isn't just teaching, coaching, officiating, and playing. Those are all really, really important because those are much more. So, a couple of years ago, it was the 20th anniversary of the Women's FA ceasing to exist and becoming part of the FA, and we did a big project with the FA called Kick Off Your Cricket. And we took 20 women who worked in football and just talked about what they did. We created a little booklet. We've got some money around, so it's worth having a look. So, in a very simple way, much like what we've done with you guys, just talked about the fact that there are many and varying ways to do sports. The other thing we've tried to do is what we do when we really research things. We're really into our research. It's kind of the heart of what we do. And Virginia mentioned when she was talking about the number of women and the percentage of women that work in the sports industry at the highest levels and how that affects as we move further down. So one of the things that we do is we hold the industry's accounts. So every year we literally count the number of women working in senior roles. There's a governing recommendation that kind of mandates. So by 2017, all publicly funded governing bodies need to have at least 25% women on their boards. Again, as we said, we actually only 25% is enough, but it's 30. But we will continue to help those national governing bodies get more women. But we'll also tell them they're failing, and that's another one of our jobs. And then another element of it is actually what we can actually do to women and men who are passionate about women's sports. So this isn't just about working with women. This is about working with the sports industry to understand the more people we have working that reflect the world, i.e. men, women, different colours, different creeds, everything. If sport is part of society, then those working in it should reflect that society, and then we're going to produce a better product. Because, you know, it's really hard for me to design a product for a 7-year-old boy, much as I might try. But maybe I'm doing a little bit something that's a little bit different about a woman in her 30s. Now I don't know that old, just impressive, isn't it? So we have a big women's sport network, which is for men and women, and we bring them all together, they get to talk and network, some of the stuff we did today, they get inspired by each other, they get to meet each other, but we also provide some mentoring as well, so that they can really, you know, look at those people that are there. Let's give you a really good example. Debbie Jevons, one of the ladies that you guys know, she's now chief executive of London 2015 World Cup. She was the first ever director of sport for an Olympic Games. Certainly, I was certain in an event, I was like, anytime anyone came to me with a shortlist of people I needed to interview, that shortlist didn't affect the world I lived in. I read it up and threw it away. So, half of his executive team was female, half the world's people. So, it's those sorts of things, working with those sorts of people who can give that message that says we can have a diverse workforce in sport that affects the diverse world.
Just in a brief nutshell, tell us a bit about your interesting career, the pathway, and the avenue to where you are today.
So, I like to think of myself as a sticker rock. If you cut me in half, you're just going to find a sport. It's everything I know and it's everything I love. The moment I could walk, I was running around, kicking balls, catching balls, throwing balls, hitting balls, sports balls. And I love sport and it's all I've ever known. But I was also pressured very much by my parents to work hard at school. So I've got really strong academics, but all of that because I had to be organised and do my work because I wanted to train and I wanted to play. And I knew I was going to work in sport and I thought I was going to be a sports journalist. And I went to Loughborough to study sports science and English to be a sports journalist, and I saw this job called Advocacy Union President that I needed to run for election to. And then I got pretty seriously injured, so I couldn't play anymore for 6 years. Grew to the side of the house, sat at my desk and learned to work in sport. And from working in sport at Loughborough with my career mentor, Denton McCall Bogthorpe, an East Midlands man, he's kind of the godfather of sports development in this country. I'd pick up the phone any day of the week and talk to him. Having worked with him, I understood what it meant to work in sport. All it means is that you get to work with people who care about things. And you get to do the thing you love. So if we're not about making money, and that's the beauty of working in sport, is that we can actually do something that we really care about. So you get to work in a really strong team. And then finish my sabbatical year in Loughborough, having got elected, and then went to work for British University in sport for 2 years, organising sport within higher education, and then decided I'd take a pay cut and work in football. I absolutely love it. And I went to work for a small charity called the Football Foundation. And we get that money for Rajah's football. Spent 7 years working there. And then ended up working with women in sport. So I've been with women in sport for 13 months. But for me, I don't have a specific skill set. I'm a real jack of all trades and master of none. I'm not excellent at anything, but I love sport and I know how to apply it. In fact, I can write a piece of English, I can do a bit of maths. And I can make a plan, but I get to do it in a world that I really give a damn about and that I really care about. So that's my history.
Thank you very much, Laura. Becky, sitting at the end there, thank you very much for coming on this evening. First question for you, what do you think are some of the biggest challenges that girls think about when facing GCSE, A-level career options in sport?
So I think sport and what champion is still not in the middle. Most of that, majority of the UC class, was what I was saying earlier, the more girls and four girls and a few that are in the class. So it is still not limited, but I think they'll just be embarrassed. They're a bit embarrassed, the boys over there watching the UK, like, what can they participate? The boys think they're better than the girls at school. And obviously, if you join the UK, that's something exciting. And of course, you know, you don't have to go to the next class, it's not quite exciting. It's been always kind of, I think also when I was at school, the parents as well, they seemed to think that it's not a very subject. So I would sooner take people say it's a subject rather than feel it's you'll learn all that with body and
scientific
is that side of it as well. Obviously there's so many careers now in sports and women.
It's probably worth saying at this point, you may or may not know that, but I won't get back to the season, but you can find Becky all the time, which is a fantastic example of what the school has done locally. You used to play school in India.
So yeah, 5 years ago I went here, and I did all my music volunteers. I started doing JTS, and then the Junior Sports Leadership Award, went to my Junior Sports Leadership Award, and also my Junior Sports Leadership Award. And then I was very fortunate as well, in some fans, I'm going to do my level one, level two football. My passion is football as well. Players in terms of and I've got through to the coaching side of things as well, which that got me where I am now, really. Through that, I managed a coaching job at the Yorkshire Leadership Council, and now I'm a village games officer, so it's about being active in more rural areas. That's just basically like through my coaching here at the
school. So you say it's fair to say that your teachers and staff here have given you encouragement.
Yeah. Originally, when I was it was all I wanted to do was be a teacher. So that's kind of all I really knew. It was like, you want to be a teacher, so you can be a teacher. But then I was still not going to be a teacher. But like that happened to me, I was there later, and sports helmet side of things as well. So it's a good
Okay, and what is it that you absolutely love about working in school? What is it for you?
For me, it's the job satisfaction. What I do is we set up lots of sessions, mainly very active. So our job really is trying to get the main active people just do a little bit something. So it's not really based on sport, we do a lot of setting up gym classes and cycling rides. And just seeing those people, I've got one lady who does some of our sessions, and in the past 4 months she's lost a stone in the weight, she was doing absolutely nothing before. And she's had to do a stone, she's changed her diet. She goes to fitness classes 3 times a week now, and that's all, you get to see that, and that's what we've helped her to achieve her goals. And it's amazing to see.
Very rewarding.
But for me, like, it's like, just like, Gail, she said it with me, she couldn't get upset by it, and now she's going for the test. It's just interesting. It's like,
What about mums and dads? Anybody here have worked in sport, or was it ever an option for you?
Quite a lot of people, actually, when they first start, they're 120k. Yeah, that's when we sold out.
55,000, it's going to be amazing. Brilliant. Anyone going to the UK to get somewhere? Brilliant. Thank you, Becky. Brilliant, thank you very much. And Andy, he's joined us this evening as well. Do you want to tell the guys a bit about your role here as well?
Yeah, I'm a PE school sport apprentice and I'm based in Highfield. Went through the Youth Sports Leadership Academy all the way from year 7, and this was offered to us. It's like the next step, really. And I get to work in all the different years, assisting the lessons. So I've seen firsthand the problems and all the things that we've mentioned tonight as well.
So, Andy, do you think the girls face different challenges to boys when it comes to
this? Yeah, definitely. I mean, similar to some of the things Becky has said, girls tend to be more self-conscious, especially about the body image and how they look and what they think about, especially the boys. And as you said, being sweaty, girls are all about their boys, you know, most of them tend to just, they don't care, not bother. Those girls do, they are bothered, they worry what they're doing. So that's one of the biggest things that you know, just come apart from.
Absolutely.
It doesn't make me, because when I was at school, it would be a lot more than a family. We had to have showers, and I don't understand why they did that. I mean, that's, you go out and play off it, so you come back and we have to have a shower, and none of them we have to do it. But that's how I felt that aspect of it.
It goes back to the thing, probably the body image issue, being able to come to yourself after your showers, which we are with the, yeah, I said, because I was a friend that's no longer going to shower, and drink meals at the end of the day, so you just get changed and go to your bed home. Yeah, that was quite a long time ago now, so that hasn't changed much, which is a real shame.
I remember.
When it went off, didn't it? It went from a normal shower, yeah. And then we allowed them to say they were self-conscious and allowed them to wear swimming costumes as they were showering. And then even that, we were even doing that.
I think really what they do in the club is encouraging them. They don't encourage them at all really, but most of the time they don't put them down. Especially if you're playing football matches or against a team, you bring a girl up and she makes people like, oh, I'm very proud of that, and they should be encouraging them to come on. That's one of the biggest things to put them down really. If you're not encouraging them, why are they involved?
What do we need to do, do you think, to get more, this is a bit of an open question, to get more boys coming on the journey? Because it is about young men like yourselves coming on tonight, hopefully being inspired by the women that you see in the film, or from the names that we talked about, that the girls have met and have spoken to. What actually needs to happen?
Could not do it at all, but they sort of encouraged me to get better and sort of talk me through the rules and things like that. So that sort of raised my confidence in that sport anyway, and then we did the same thing in the basketball.
So
it
showed
the
girls,
so,
yeah, showed
boys
the
days are there. Yeah, well, there's that information there in sport. There are some that made them that would be as good as girls and even as each other. So, for example, I'm watching football, but if I can play with someone that's good at football, then obviously that's the same thing as maybe a girl thing, but I don't know. Yeah, just think about that, you know, just sort of show them that they're not. That's it.
Okay, final question for you, Andy. As an expert for you, you've involved in the fantastic leadership academy that we know you've got here. What can schools do to provide the opportunities available for girls?
Well, especially in Highfield, we've got the Voice of Sport, and we've got male and female representatives, so everyone can say what they want. Also, the young ambassadors, the leadership program, you know, other schools can get them as well, and they've got a better chance of saying anything from a male's perspective and a female's perspective, and they can hear everyone's views.
Fantastic. Guys, thank you very much. That was really interesting. I'm going to ask the girls to come up on some stage.
stage now and enjoy the good fun. Thank you. This is the stars of the show, these are the girls that have been, I can hands on heart say they've been an absolute pleasure to work with. And I genuinely, certainly, and I say they have inspired not just me, but I think that is straight back to certainly our organisation. In a way, we're really miles away from here, but we're not, and it really has. Thank you, girls, to start with. So, a few questions for you just to share your journey. How has the work you've done with us made you think differently about a possible career within sports?
I think before I went to my first show to get the film,
Maybe is it something? Is it really open your eyes up to the world of fashion now that you can aspire to be a work for a sports brand, a design brand label? Mm-hmm. So we know you had the opportunity to meet a number of women who work with. Such as Claire Balding, Debbie Jones, and Grant, and Transport, and presenters such as Charlie Webster and Jane Duke, who I know spent a lot of time with you guys at the Thursday episode of the conference a couple of weeks ago. So, who would you say for you girls to be some of the most inspirational women that you've met in the process of working together with us? Anybody else? Fantastic to be doing. I think it's also worth pointing out when the girls came to London in the first instance, it wasn't just a 2-minute bit of time they had. Not only did they work their socks off for about 9 hours solid, they spent probably a good hour with each of the women, and there were some really interesting conversations going on. So there was a lot more that was certainly I mean, I saw as well as the girls did. So it's quite an inspirational day. Anybody else? Anybody else in particular? Who was a fan of Claire Balding? Yeah, she was fantastic, wasn't she?
We interviewed her and she made me feel really at home. She used to interview people, so she sat us down and then she was asking, what were we doing it for and how are we going to put our experience across to people? So she knows we're really at home.
Everyone loves me, Claire. She's a bit of a legend. So, has meeting women who work in the world of sport and have followed their passion and ambition inspired you to now think about doing the same?
Ever seen something like my pathways or and then that was just that each of the things would be different, like I went to an example, they all went through it and you're just coming on Jesus and you've got to let that out, which they will be using a little bit of the sport. So even if I don't go
fantastic. And Mr. Lewis is absolutely right. We need to make sure that we can spread the inspiration that you guys have got from this to other schools and internally with the school and wider than that as well. It's something that we're working with you. So do you think there are enough positive role models within the world of sport for girls? And who would you say your role models are?
So, I think our role models is not happening yet.
Did it give you more?
Yeah.
about who your role models? Mum and dad? So people you see on a daily basis that you're working with at home and at school have a positive influence on you. Excellent. What have been the biggest messages that you've learned from the journey that you've been on?
The biggest message is to take everything to you, because
and I think that's, I can certainly from my hand, I can say that, you know, I'm still relatively young in my career, I get given opportunities and I, you know, love to take them up and do it because I want to do well and I want to continuously learn. There's a lady sitting in this room, I won't mention who the lady is, but for me, who's a, you might only have had the good fortune of her over the last couple of years, but it's encouraging and inspiring me, certainly giving me opportunities. So it doesn't matter how young or old you are, we can continuously strive to be better. And like I said, you girls have inspired me as well, so it works both ways. Girls, thank you so much. Round of applause for the girls. I'm just going to hand it to the girls. I know that they wanted to say a few words themselves as well. Over to you.
We just want to say thank you to the salad and the opportunity to be here. I'm just going to let you know. And in the second one,